Hi, fellow map makers. Welcome to tonight's live mapping session. I'm Ralf Schemann of ProFantasy Software, and I'm happy to take you through the creation of another map tonight. After doing quite a few dungeons lately, tonight I want to take another look at creating city maps or town maps with Campaign Cartographer and City Designer. And I've chosen one of the styles from this year's Cartographer's Annual for tonight's session, the Rycroft Towns style by Monkey Blood Design, a fellow freelancer and mapmaker who's created a few drawing styles for the annuals over the years. And I particularly like his town style, which is really wonderful. And I want to show you that tonight. As usual, welcome to anybody who's new to our live mapping sessions. I'm gonna take it slowly and explain a few things along the way so that new users can learn as much as possible from these videos. As well as hopefully from a few of the old guys, some tips and tricks that they haven't seen before. Alright, let's take a quick tour through the drawing interface. We've got the drawing window here with example map showing, where all the mapping action is going to take place. This is an example map from the annual. And to the left of that is the catalog window, which shows a selection of symbols that you can place in the map. For this style, obviously house and building symbols. To the left of that are the toolbars for drawing tools and editing functions here in the center and at the bottom. And further to the left of that, the color selection bar. Above the drawing window is the catalog toolbar, which lets you switch through different symbol catalogs depending on the style you're using. And up and above that is the file toolbar, where you can open and save new maps, print, and go through the different menus from the different add-ons to Campaign Cartographer. Above that is the properties bar, which shows the current drawing properties selected, like fill styles, colors, the current sheet we're working on, and so on. And above that is the menu, where you can also select all the commands from and different options. To the right of the drawing area is the CAD toolbar with all the basic CAD functionalities like drawing individual entities, entity ordering, and all the zoom functions. And finally, at the bottom of the screen, very important, is the command line, which shows the current command and the options you're getting. But this will also pop up at the mouse cursor if you have the option selected, as you can see here. And to the bottom right, the grid options for the drawing grid, which may become important at the end of our mapping session tonight, but we'll see about that. Let's start out. Oh, one thing, if you have any questions during the session, don't hesitate to post them as comments on the Facebook post under the video, and Sue will collect these and forward them to me so I can, and I will stop occasionally during the session to answer questions. All right, that said, let's get going. And I'm starting out by clicking the new map button up here on the file toolbar. And this, I'm not going to save this map. This brings up the new drawing wizard, which lets you set up your new, an empty map you're working on. The first thing to select is the map type you want to draw. And as I mentioned, we're going to do cities today. So I'm going to choose that, click next, and then select one of the many available drawing styles. These are the ones that come with City Campaign Cartographer and City Designer. and some things from the symbol sets down here, and lots of different styles from the Cartographer's Annual. Over the years, many different styles have accumulated, and we're choosing one of these from this year, and that's the annual Rycroft Town style. I'm going to click Next, and here we set the size of the map. For a city map, that will be in feet, and I'm going to leave that at the default 1000 by 800 feet. That nicely fills the screen, and it is a good size for a small town or village, and that's the most we can tackle in a live mapping session like this, if you want to get to some kind of finished map. And that's it here for the moment. I'll just click Finish to start. Yes, I'm going to finish to start. That's right. To start actually drawing the map. And let's see, I'm going to call this Rycroft Example. And I've got the blank background for the map I want to draw. So what do I want to draw? I was thinking about that, and one type of map I haven't really done much. Most of my town maps are placed along rivers or at the coast with the harbor. So instead, let's do something else this time. Let's create a town on a hill. And for that, we'll need a hill first. So let's take a look. Oh, each style usually has a contour type of drawing tool. And then we're going to see how that looks. Let's see the terrain contour higher. And let's draw a hill. Start. This will be my hill outline. Not perfectly circular, but a general round hill. And as you can see, this style uses brightening contours to show higher in elevation. Well, that's not something I really want to go for in this map. This is nice for some contours around the edges or in individual parts, but it doesn't look so good if the hill is the center and one of the main features of the map. So Sue mentions that the resolution is a bit blobby, and that's right. That's because CampaignCartographer uses a lower resolution sometimes to make drawing faster, displaying the map actually, but it's obviously not so nice for video display. Let's click the display speed settings here and set our to fix bitmap quality very high. And then that's probably also a bit of the setting I have here, but this looks good from the resolution. Yeah, that's better. Okay, where were we? I want to make the hill stand out more. I want to give it a shadow effect. And for that, we need to go into the sheet effects. See, I'm going to click the sheet indicator up here. That brings up the sheets and effects dialog. And we are working on the contour sheet here. And this has the edge fade inner effect. That's if I turn that off and apply the effect, you'll see that the edge between the contour line and the background is very precise, and the edge fade makes that the border softer between those two. So let's turn that on and apply again. There we can see the difference. And let's now add a different sheet effects. For what I'm using to create a shadow effect on hills is a lighted bevel. Basically, that's for showing edges that stand up or go down and the light that falls on them. And basically, a hill is a bit like that, except it's not going to have a plateau in the middle, this one. And for that, we need to increase the bevel to a size so that it spans the that basically doesn't leave a plateau in the center. And for that, I'm gonna we just need a very large number, because anything that's above the distance of the hill is just ignored. So we're taking 500 units, level size, and let's leave the rest for the moment, except for the smoothing I'm going to do, because it's a rounded smooth hill. I'm going to apply some smoothing here. Let's see for the moment how this looks. And if we turn this off. So, see, that's... you can see the light is coming from the upper left, and the lower right of the hill is in shadow. And there's a pretty dark and black shadow. That's the edges are still very harsh, so we do definitely need more smoothing. So I'm going to edit the sheet effect again. Let's increase the smoothing by another factor of 10. Let's make the whole intensity a bit less, so the shadows don't get quite as large. The lightness base is basically the color, the lightest version of the the average lightness of the bevel. So if you increase that or make that a little bit lower, it will be darker. So let's try that with 75% first. Apply. Actually, 75% is lighter, of course. I wanted to make that a little bit darker. No, I think the 50% is probably best here. And if we decrease the lightness range a bit, see, then it gets smoothed out, more general shadows. If we do the 25% here, let's get even darker. 50-50 is quite good, but perhaps we can still reduce the intensity a little bit to 50%. So that looks pretty good. For a hill, we might even make the smoothing still a bit stronger. Yep, that's fine. Let's see whether we already at and if we make that even larger. No, that's, you see, that doesn't make any more difference. We could try, if you know, it looks, if we keep a little plateau in the center. See, there's the plateau, but the plateau unfortunately tends to be fairly strongly defined. And that's why I don't like it as much. Now we're gonna go back to a higher value, full hill. Okay, there's our hill on the map. Can turn the effect off if we don't want to show it for a moment. See, that's only gives us the outline of the hill, but for working, I'll leave the bevel effect on. Okay, so that's a good thing to start, and then might perhaps want a little stream running down the hill, and or running into a small river or a larger stream at the bottom. For that, I'm gonna click the All City Drawing Tools and choose a small stream. Start not quite at the top. And continue the wider stream. Gonna use the endpoint modifier. That's the F5. And it's good. Although we might, this step here is perhaps a bit large. So what we can do, we can split the stream here somewhere and change the line width of this section to average of 5 and 10 to 70.5. See, we'll have a slow widening of the stream here. And at the bottom, we're gonna make this run into a little small river. Nothing major. There we go. Looking pretty good. So next, what I like to do to outline my town, if it has a feature like that, is the city map. City wall. We do have some symbols for that here. A town wall, an easy one, and a wider city wall somewhere. There, the city wall. But this is made out of symbols, and I wanted to make it a bit easier for this. We also have a drawing tool for that. If you click all drawing tools and take a look at the city walls up here, we've got city walls in different widths. The 10 feet and 20 feet versions have a walkway on top. The 5 feet version is just a straight stone wall. So I'm gonna go for the 10 foot wall. And I'm just gonna sit the city wall will be mostly at the bottom of the hill. Just drawing it across the hole. Let's go a little bit further down the stream here. And there's my city wall. Zoom in, see it's casting the shadow. And I could use this, for example, as a opening for the stream, but what I can also do, I can just close these two lines into a closed path. For that, I'm gonna right click this spot, the explode button, and choose the path to polygon. That means basically an open path is converted into a closed polygon. Select the city wall by clicking on the center of the line and pressing D for do it. And there we have a closed city wall. So that's going to define the boundary of our town. Perhaps we'll put a few symbols outside the wall, but let's see how that goes. And let's first lay down some streets. Well, what we actually could do, we could add a little castle on top of the hill. That would make sense. A castle at the crown of the hill, probably the original center of the town. And how we're going to do that, we don't have a big castle symbol or something like that in this style, but we can use the wider city wall for that. So let's turn on the grid here, and that way I'm going to just draw a rectangular castle. Actually, this should actually be no, that's let's redo that. Actually, I can change that later. First thing I wanted to do is make this into a polygon as well, so it's closed. See, I didn't end the wall at the same height as where I started it, but I can change this. I can just click Node Edit, click this, and that moves the corner of the wall up there. And then I want to add some castle towers to this. Let's make these a little bit larger. Right-clicking gives you access to the symbol parameters. And the city symbols are set up so they align to existing roads and other entities, which makes it nice and easy to align the towers here to the castle walls. Once you click, it then gives you the option to set the distance from the insertion point, but I'm just gonna put it on the corner here. And one down here at the left. And we can put a nice big dungeon or something in the center of the castle. Let's do that. Set the scale back to 1. Perhaps make it even a bit smaller. And put a big tower in here. So this is going to be our castle. Now it's would be time to add a little bit of streets to the city map. I like to do that to define the layout of the different sections of the city, and we do have drawing tools for that here for the road. I right-click the road drawing tool button, and this gives me a selection of different versions of the road. I've got some grassy stuff for overland paths, I've got muddy roads, I've got paved roads for the center of the town, or the more important streets of the town, and I've also got some polygons that I can draw for squares, and I'm going to start by using the square paved for the marketplace or something, which I'm going to put in front of the castle. And let's have it extend here a bit. That's going to be the big central square for the town. And now I'm going to use some paved roads. Let's start a 10-foot road for a bigger one. Say, where do I want my, the main gate of the town to be? Up here on the right. Just gonna draw the street up to the city wall. Then I'm gonna draw another one going around the center line of the hill's height, all the way back here to the square. Let's have another one run along the ridge here, and using the on modifier or F9, putting this here. Have another one run around the base of the hill. Okay. And then let's add some smaller ones, 5 foot, to connect streets. These will be going to be pretty steep, or we can have them move or lead along the incline a little bit. If we have it going straight down, it's going to be a pretty steep street, but that's not unheard of. Yeah. Street up here. Let's have a winding path go up the ridge here. And another one down this way. We might probably want another town gate. Only one is a bit unlikely. You'll have traffic running through the town probably. So we're gonna take another bit of the bigger road and have it run up here to the city gate, and one here and another city gate here. And we can now also add couple more squares, smaller squares here in the city. There's one here. Another one here at the gate. And to connect that to the outside, I'm going to use the muddy road style for the roads leading off from the town. Just connect it to the same sections. And this is not quite far enough, so I take the node edit tool and put that up here. And another one here on the left. I did actually take a different fill style here. This is the dirt style, where this was the mud style, but that's going to be fine for now. Okay, that looks pretty good for the outline of the town, so let's take a look and add some buildings to the actual town. But first off, let's take a look at the questions that have come in the meantime. Sue asks whether a broader edge fade on the hill might be better to better blend the hill into the outline. Yes, that's certainly possible, though I think the interior of the town will basically already take good care of that, but we could increase the size of the edge fade effects. Let's make it 25 feet. And you see that basically that makes the hill a bit smaller and merge it better into the background. So that's pretty good. We'll leave it at this. Okay, I was gonna draw some buildings. Now what you can do, you can just take one of the symbols here, take a house, set the symbol size back to 1, to the default. Just click somewhere on the street, place the house, take another one. The tab key goes through a list of different symbols in the tool. See, you can switch between different ones and just add the buildings like this. But what we can also do, we can use the random street tool. Click that with the right mouse button to go to the options, and you can see lots of different style here from different city map styles. The CA161 is the Raycroft style. And see, you can choose different sized houses here to place along the street. Let's take small, narrow houses close together. And we then left-click the button. We get a little pick symbol. Can just select a street, then choose a starting point, and see, place buildings along the street like that. See, this gives me the outline. I can always move the mouse back and forth, and each time I move along the street, it gives me a new selection of houses. So if I have something like this that doesn't fit over the stream, I can just go back until I've got a selection that fits. But I can also go in later and move and delete individual houses. And with that, I'm going to fill in a bit of a bulk of the buildings for the town. Of course, that's so much quicker and easier than going through each individual building and placing it by hand. So I'm gonna use the small buildings down here for the big back of the hill. Basically, this is gonna be my poorer section of town. Houses will be smaller, closer together. You can adjust the setup of the tool of the street settings here by clicking the street settings and choosing different styles of houses you want. Basically, these are house styles. So I'm seeing there's a little bit off. There's a metric style in here. Won't really matter that much on this kind of map, but I'm gonna change that to a blue roof tile. And you can see some of the houses will have a blue roof color. Save that. Oh, that was. This is the house drawing tool, and this allows me to draw individual houses in defined shapes. See, I want a bit larger building in a special shape, which I might not have the symbol for. I can just take that and draw the house on the map, just like the buildings from the random street tool. See here, I'm gotten a bit too close to the path, so I'm just gonna erase this individual building. Each can be moved and erased individually. A few more buildings here. And we need something here for the city gate. What you can do, you can just place two or one tower on there. City gates used to often be in the towers themselves in medieval times, or you can just select a wall symbol, place it on top of the wall. See if we want to use this as the symbol for our city gate. It works nicely. Let's move up here a little bit. Take the tool to add a few more buildings. See, small and very curvy streets like that don't work too well with the house tool. Either the houses overlap or it skips some sections. So in places like these, you might be better off placing individual houses on the street, either the symbols or with the house tool. See, the house point of the roof is aligned with the first side of the house. If you draw, if I go this way, you can see that the roof will be aligned the same way. If I go the other direction, the roof will be this way. You can also go in, if you want to do special things, add extensions to a house. Here's an extra. Use one of these extensions, insert that. So it asks me for a point within the house. Then the house edge, then the distance from the house edge, and then the width of the extension. And that way you've got the extension. After the fact, you can also do extension like that with this house shape in one go, if you know beforehand that you're going to be using that. I'm gonna go back to the random street tool. Oh, this is actually a bit too narrow here, so let's go from the other side. This is okay. And this is obviously too large, so I'm just gonna delete that. But careful, don't wanna delete my precious hill. So, as we go up here, we're gonna change to some a little bigger houses. If I want to place the house without aligning to the street as I'm doing here, I can just right click and disable smart symbols for a moment. See the I have now full control over the symbol. I can scale and rotate it myself. Put a big house here at the end of the hill. And turn the smart feature back on. Set the house back to normal. And here we'll just place some bigger houses. This is going to be an important street. So let's take a little bit of care around the marketplace. We've got a temple here. Obviously needs to be right on the side of the marketplace. We've got the town hall, which is already getting a bit large. Again, I'm gonna disable smart symbols here to have a little more control. Little bit smaller. Place the town hall. And now we've got a well, which fits nicely on the center of the marketplace. I would like a gate in the wall of the castle, and for that I'm just going to use one of the square tower, so this is going to be the main entrance to the castle. And I'm at this point I'm noticing that I might want a courtyard or something along those lines in the center of the castle. I just go to the drawing tools and choose the square paved and just draw it around the castle. And you can see. So what you can see at this point is where I draw the roads above the hill. It obscures the shadow. So you don't see the shadow casting off the hill on top of the streets. If you want to change that, you can do that by moving the contour down in the list so it's behind the roads. And now the problem is a bit that it obscures this a little bit too much. It's now nicely in the shadow, but that also means that we don't see the street very well anymore. So I'm probably go back to the previous version and leave it at that. It might work better if we had a more standout field style, different from the background on the streets, but it works like this as well. So I'm going to fill up the northern half of the town with larger houses. For that I'm going to switch to large houses, a bit too much. We're going to switch to the default house size for the drawing tool and use that to place. Houses here. Yep, and another one here along this section. Don't bother about whether every house is correctly where you want it to be. We can always go in and delete individual ones or move them. This is the move command. Select, do it. Rotate the building. There we go. We've got a street along here. Yeah. Few buildings at the back of the castle. Looking fairly good. We would have space to add a few more buildings here on this side. So I'm gonna add a smaller track again by using the on modifier on an existing road. Along here, and then I'm going to switch to the small houses again. That's probably a bit too narrow here. Oh no, we can fit a few houses in. There we go. Looking pretty good, and we can also still add a few houses along the outside so that the town is probably growing and a few buildings are built outside of the town hall walls. This we can also do if we know we are using the street tools on both sides of the street. We can deselect this and choose houses on both sides at the same time. Like this. Okay, what we need is some, as Sue just mentions, trees, yes, but I was going to keep that for a little bit. What I want to do first is add some city wall towers, because we still, for that, that makes it easy if I use the round towers and perhaps a little bit smaller. It's just a small town wall. The towers won't be that big. Just place the towns here, the left and right of the street, and This makes for a perfectly fine city gate. Another one in here. And then a few at the corners. Town wall towers would normally be placed at the corners, so you have a good field of view and fire across both sections of the wall adjacent to that, to it. On here, this would looks like a good place for another tower. And one here. So that's nice. And now we do need some trees. We've got a nice tree symbol here. Set that back to normal. And these can be sprinkled nicely and easily across the town. There will be some gardens behind the houses, and there might be the occasional apple tree and other fruit tree in here. And it just looks nice if you have some vegetation showing on the map. So even a little grove in here. Else, how do we have in symbols? Oh, that's good. What we might want to put in is a few of the small wooden bridges to cross the stream. People wouldn't want to wade over the stream in their town every time they cross it. One here and one here. And now we just need some vegetation around the town. With that, I right click the drawing tools and look at my terrain options here. We've got some different grass, fields is good. Just wondering whether these are not showing their field styles. Terrain fields brown. Let's have a look. Oops, just the preview. No. See if I draw. Oh, it's working fine. Ah, I know why. It's because it's in a line field style, and this doesn't show in the. It's basically a macro behind the drawing tool, and there's no preview for that. So that's why the fill is not showing in the preview. But this works just fine. And go to all the terrain fields again. Let's do green fields, and this basically aligns the field style to the first edge you're drawing of your polygon. Towns like these will almost always have a big selection of fields around them, as the populace needs to be fed. So I'm adding quite a few of those around town. Like to vary these between different colors so it doesn't get too boring on the map. and have some little sections between these where I can play, place hedgerows or rows of trees where fields would be separated from each other. Okay, looks good. So see, we have got the hedgerows here that we could use to place along the fields. But this is gonna take a little bit too long, will be a little bit too much work. So I'm gonna stick with trees for this map for the time being. Use some trees here to show hedges or overgrown walls between the fields. Another one just takes a little bit of time to place all the symbols. Patience is a virtue in drawing maps. The more time you invest in symbol placement and adding little details to your map, the better it will look in the end. So while I'm working pretty quickly here, more quickly than I usually would to be able to finish the map in about an hour, and you normally would take a little more time in placing these symbols, like putting trees in regular distance beside a road to show an alleyway, a tree-lined road. I can't remember the English word for that at the moment. An allee in German, but an alley is something different in English. And here we go. That looks pretty nice. So what I want to add now is a scale bar and compass rows and a title for the map. So see, these symbols are varicolor symbols. They take on the color of the that's currently selected, but I'm gonna do them as black. So, this is the north direction, and for the compass rows I need to set the size so I know which length it depicts. The default size is always 100 feet, so I'm gonna set it to, that was a bit too quick, to normal. And let's take a little bit closer look. So actually a bit too short to more look good on the map, so I'm gonna increase the size to double that. It's looking pretty good. Place this here and type in 200 for 200 feet. Okay, so we just need a name for our town. We do have the map title as a symbol here as well that we can use instead of using the text tool. So what's the hardest part for maps is always naming everything. So let's get this downhill. Oh, this is probably a bit too large. So I'm gonna move that and scale it a bit. And it's not on the correct sheet. See, it's behind the trees. So I'm gonna use that to move to sheet and place it on the text sheet. Ah, and actually the text here is set up with a dark outline, so you can use a bright text color. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to change the color of the text. For that I just change properties, select the baseline of the text, I click and do it, and choose a bright color. Let's take the white, and that's how it's supposed to look. And now you can go in and do the same with our little more labels. Placing the text, I choose on my layers and other properties. So that's this Stonehill Castle. Actually, let's make that a multi-line. This is going to be a bit smaller. Castle. And label the marketplace. The temple. And the town hall, and that way you can continue adding labels to the town. I'm just going to do these few ones. And what you can do at this point, you can go in and do a reference grid on the map. For that, I'm just gonna add a grid to the city, add grid overlay. You want a square grid, let's say a 20 foot grid, or 20 foot is perhaps a bit too small, 50 foot is probably okay, like we had for the default. This time we want to label this because we want a reference. So I'm gonna use letters for the x-axis and numbers for the y-axis. Labels outside, not within the cells. Apply. See the labels vanish behind the map border. We can change that by moving the grid down in the list. That was not far enough yet. One more down. No. No, there it is. It's just not very visible. What I'm gonna do, I'm because I want the grid very faint and invisible, but the labels of the grid fairly prominent, I'm gonna switch these to a different sheet. If I wanted to do that directly, say move to sheet, take that, you'll see I'm selecting the whole grid, all the text and grid lines vests, because the grid together with this, with its labels, is a grouped entity. So we need to make this do this a little bit differently. What we're gonna do first, I'm gonna hide everything but the grid sheet. Now, because it's white on white, we don't see anything. So what we do, we change the view window color. It's basically the background of our mapping area. And if we change that to something darker, we're going to see our grid again. Also going to turn off my sheet effects. See if we can see the grid now properly. What I'm not going to do, I'm going to unlock groups. So, and then I'm going to move to sheet by entity type and all 2D text. See, I've selected all the text. Grid lines are unaffected. Press D for do it and move this to plain text. That way, we now show everything again and turn on my sheet effects. You can see my grid labels are now nicely visible again. What I actually should do, I should change the text properties of these. Selecting by prior is always a useful function. If you just edited something and want to edit it again, choose select by prior and you'll just grab the same entities as you had in your last selection. And I'm going to do a more straightforward font because that other font is too elaborate to be good for labels like these. But what we also should do is probably move that down a bit because it's vanishing at the edge of the map border. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to hide everything again and just leave the map border showing. Oh, what I also need to. We go. And now we can select just these here, but not the border. Oh, did I actually not grab the. This and I'm gonna combine with end the entity text. Now I have these selected, do it, and I'm gonna move these down here inside of the grid. Same on this side of the map. Now I just have to see whether we have enough space for our numbers there. We're not overlapping. Well, this was, moved it a bit up accidentally. And the same up here on that side. It's a bit close together. It's probably best if we change the text properties a bit. Let's use extract properties first so I know which size the text currently is. And if I now do change text properties by all text, do it. And let's make the size 7 feet 6 inch smaller. And better. Show everything again. And there we've got my text labels properly visible inside of the grid. What I now can also do is add an index for the map. Say I'm going to change the color to black. And city create index by entity type text. I'm indexing the text. on the map. Oh, actually, I probably should not take index the index numbers themselves. So I'm gonna select not all the text at the edges of the map. Do it and place the index in here, and it shows me at which coordinate these buildings are. So if I click, and I can even click on the temple here, and it will jump to the temple in the map. It's nice for larger references, especially if you don't want all the text in the middle of the map and just replace these with numbers. That way you can have the description of the buildings off to the side of the map and just number references on the map, so it doesn't obscure too much. I can now change the window color back to white. And I'm basically done with my map. Let's have a look. Not too many questions tonight. I hope you still enjoyed that. But Sue has another one. Can you edit the format of the text in the legend? You mean in the scale bar? Probably. That's a bit more complicated because that's a text attribute. You would have to go into the definition of the symbol and edit the text in there. And this is a bit too complicated at this point. So I'm not going to do that here. You can do that though, yes. But it's then might even be easier to just erase the text and add your own. So it means the, you can simply change the properties in here. With change properties, change text properties, select this, do it, and choose something else here, an old style, make it a bit smaller. Okay, and change the text properties of the index, just like other text. This. You can also go in and scale this. Say you wanted to make this a bit larger. Click scale, select everything here up here. Scale point, turn off snap, and make it a bit larger. Okay, so we're ready to export, print our map, or use it right here on the screen. And I hope you enjoyed tonight's map making session. Just a bit of an announcement. Next week is Gen Con Online, and we'll be running a few mapping seminars on there. I'll have a look and see whether any spots are still unfilled. And oh, we have a late visitor here. Hi, Asa. Map making's almost done. You're almost too late. And if there's any spots left in the Gen Con seminars, I'm going to post those here on the on Facebook. And if anybody wants to join, they're welcome to. Otherwise, we'll see whether we can make the videos available as well at a later time. And instead, Remy will do a live mapping session next Thursday, which I'm looking forward to myself. So see you again next week and enjoy your map making at home. Until then, all the best.